use evolution to undermine God.
Some right? of them do. And
well, the most famous, like Richard Dawkins, one of the most famous Darwinists in the world, if not the most famous, his entire book, The God Delusion, the central argument is to use Darwinism to undermine design.
Sure.
You see, so what I do is I make a distinction between evolution and Darwinian evolution. Now, these guys, they had a court case. You know about the Dover case?
No. Nope,
okay, they had a Dover case about intelligent design, the National Academy of Science. And you had Michael Ruse as one of the witnesses. And you also had William Dembski, Kenneth Miller, all these guys, they all came, right? Long story short, this is, because near the end of it, they say about should creationism be given equal time,
yeah.
right? Intelligent design was ruled to be pseudoscience at that time,
okay.
during the Dover case. Do you know why it was ruled to be pseudoscience? And why they call it pseudoscience?
Go ahead.
They actually ruled it by definition. They said science only deals with the natural, the observable, therefore, and it's based on methodological naturalism, therefore intelligent design is pseudoscience.
Okay, I wouldn't agree with that.
Okay, good, you don't agree with that. But just to point out,
I don't agree with intelligent design. I do agree with evolution, but I don't think the argument you just put forward is a cogent argument.
No, yeah? It is their argument that they used.
I think their argument isn't cogent on that point, and I agree with you.
Good. And the reason why that argument's not valid is because there is no clear-cut distinction between science and pseudoscience. There's a huge demarcation problem, and there's gray areas. Now, some things are clearly not science. For example, astrology. We know that that's not science. Some things clearly are science, but it's a gray area, like evolutionary psychology.
Yeah.
There's certain things there. There's certain things like Freudian theories. Are they science or not? However, the way intelligent design was pushed out by the National Academy of Sciences.
I'm not defending them for doing that.
No, but I want to point that out, because when you handed this to me, I looked at the thing right near the end where it said, why can't we teach creation science in my school? Now, this is the thing I want to point out, right?
Okay. Can I preface?
Sure.
You are slightly shifting the goalposts, I think.
Okay.
So I know that some of the materialists, some of these scientists, the hardline atheists, I think they're disingenuous in their arguments against religion. And I can agree with you on that. We don't need to spend too much time. They're a disingenuous representation for materialist scientists with regard to arguments about God. And I think Dawkins is somewhat blinded, okay? And in his recent debate with Jordan Peterson, I think you can see where that clear division is.
Or even Dennis Noble.
Yeah, okay. I think Peterson is cutting to the heart of the spirit of religion, and I know you'll have differences of opinion with him, but you'll agree that he's cutting to a metaphysical dimension that Dawkins seems to be immune to.
Yeah, I wouldn't say immune to. I would say his epistemology doesn't recognize it.
Yeah, okay.
Because he's fundamentally a follower of scientism. Yeah. He says God is a scientific hypothesis.
Yeah.
So when you have that kind of blinkers on, you're not going to see what Peterson's saying or other thinkers are saying. And to be honest, this is not everything Peterson was saying is things that Keith Ward would have said to Dawkins years ago.
Okay.
I mean, these are things which are really well known. But the reason why I pointed this out is because the National Academy of Sciences, what they did in their argument against intelligent design was unethical.
Okay, maybe it was.
And I'm trying to explain to you why it was unethical.
Okay.
Now, I know you disagree with intelligent design, but on the minimum,
I think intelligent design, if you dig deeper, may be compatible with Darwinian evolution if you allow a linking kind of thought process, yeah? If you make it black or white, it has to be one or the other. But if you can see a level of symbolism maybe in this, then maybe it's compatible.
So I wouldn't even,
a lot of religions have embraced that.
So I wouldn't even say symbolic or metaphoric. I would say even if you accept the evolutionary story by natural selection and design, they are compatible. There's somebody I'm interviewing tomorrow, and I've interviewed him in the past. His name is Erki Kajonin.
Okay.
He's written a book called Evolution and Design, right? And what he does is he shows is you can have a total total naturalistic story, yet it doesn't undermine the design argument. Which, by the way, that's...
You profess he says that. I can't accept it just because you say it.
No. What I'm saying is people can make the argument that design is compatible with evolutionary theory. I don't deny
I
that.
So. I think that's the way forward.
Yeah.
So but you know I like Adamic exceptionalism. I think Adamic exceptionalism is an excellent bridging mechanism. Yeah?
Yeah.
And you've had Professor Malik, and I've seen you
guys chatting. So, that's
heading in the right direction.
No, see, that's a particular element. I want to look at the broader picture first. Okay. Because I think what's happened is this. For many, many years, Darwin's views were misrepresented. Because Darwin's views were, you can be an ardent evolutionist and you can believe in God.
Yeah, because and he was brought up in a time when belief in God was the default. He was a Christian himself, and he had to grapple with his faith in the face of his understanding of evolution, yeah?
That, it wasn't exactly like that.
Just roughly and broadly what I'm saying has some...
So, you see, the motivation wasn't due to his own religious belief. It wasn't. Because he was a deist. He didn't believe God intervened. When he published The Origin of Species, right, you're a deist, right? So you know deism states God doesn't intervene. It's not theism.
Yeah.
So for Darwin, what he had in his mind was that you can have a naturalistic process which unfolds, right? And that process is something which can dovetail with a belief in God. Now, he actually went further because he had a friend called Asa Gray, who's an American biologist, who believes in God. So Asa Gray actually was pointed out as an example by Darwin of somebody that can be an ardent evolutionist and a theist. Now, what did the neo-Darwinists do? The neo-Darwinists used evolutionary theory, one, to show it to be true in a way that is not in line with the evidence. Yep. That's the first thing they did. Secondly, they metaphysically abused it. They used it to push atheism. Right? And this is something that they've been doing for decades, and the God delusion I pointed out is one example, but there's many other examples where they did this, and we can't ignore that. Yeah.
You know much more about the facts of the history of this debate. Okay? What I'm trying to do is distill them down to an evaluation for a layman's point of view. I'm a layman.
Fine.
Now, I disagree with your conclusion, even though I know you know more facts, because knowing facts and being able to evaluate facts are not the same thing.
Okay.
What we're evaluating here is a process. I'm not responsible for all the abuse of the system by other people in the past. As a layman, what I see is, I'm explained a process called evolution, which seems fairly simple. A being, a life form will tend to reproduce a copy of itself, except occasionally there'll be a mutation. If there's a mutation, it will have a new adaptation, a new characteristic, which may fit with the environment or not. If it's advantageous in the environment, it's more likely then to be passed on to the next generation, then that becomes a new being. It's a very, very simple mechanism. And you agree that it works with regard to other species, yes?
I don't actually.
In the lab with
So I'm going to explain to you something which is very important. As a supplementary process, as a, if you like, tertiary even process, we do observe basic things, which is that if you have a particular mutation which can facilitate an adaptive feature, then you're more likely to survive than not. That's clear.
That's clear.
There's no denying that.
Okay, so far so good. So where do we differ?
So the difference is to use that to say that explains the biosphere. That's simplistic.
Yeah, it's a more ambitious claim.
Okay, not more ambitious. I would say it's an almost it's almost like using the smallest element you have and to go to the massive unknown without looking at the complexity of the world. So it's completely unjustified.
It may be that.
But let me explain to you why I believe that's the case. In 2016, and this is where I use examples of others who've said the same thing. In 2016 at the Royal Society in London, the same place where Darwin in 1858 presented...
Again, you have so many more facts.
No, but I'm explaining to you what happened. You had two groups of scientists, one led by Dennis Noble, right? Who is a non-neo-Darwinist evolutionist, and you had Darwinists. And they were arguing about this basic point. Is the simplistic notion of natural selection plus random mutation sufficient to explain all of life? And some eminent scientists believe the answer is no. Other scientists believe the answer is yes.
Is it abiogenesis, yeah? I mean, the transmission...
Sorry, say that again?
Is it abiogenesis?
No.
Jump from the material structure to the organic life structure.
No, that they didn't debate that.
They didn't debate that.
See, Darwinism begins after life.
Okay, I mean the Miliuri experiment, yeah?
No, no.
The mystery seems to be in that terrain.
No, yeah, so they weren't talking about that. They were talking about the mechanism, right? So Dennis Noble, James Shapiro, Carl Woese, and these are big figures. I'll give you an example. We have archaea, we have bacteria, we have eukarya. We have the domains of life, three domains of life. Any biology textbook, you're going to see these three domains of life. Carl Woese discovered archaea. So he is, if you like, one of the most important scientists of the last 100 years. He did not believe in natural selection plus random mutation is sufficient to explain all of life. So James Shapiro wrote a book called Evolution, A View from the 21st Century, and he's somebody who is a naturalist, but he doesn't believe in neo-Darwinism, right? Carl Woese said about his book that this is a game changer. So here we're talking about heavyweights.
I'm not going to dispute any of your facts, but I want to contextualize this.
No, but I want to contextualize it from the sense that not all scientists believe natural selection plus random mutations are sufficient for life.
I never said they did. What I'm saying is it would seem to be a point of fact. You mentioned 3 or 4 quote heavyweights, yeah? And you think they represent significant evidence in your favor. I'm just going, it looks like there's 190 Nobel Prize winners who are also heavyweights, who if they were here now and I asked, do you believe in Darwinian evolution, would say yes. And the reason I think that is they've published to that effect. Now, as a layman, which is what I am and what most of your viewers are, when I'm trying to work out where does the truth lie, if I was trying to be objective and honest with myself, I think I would be unwise to conclude that the four heavyweights that you listed completely obliterate any consideration I should give to 190. I'm not saying you're wrong, but I'm just trying to, methodologically, I think there should be an element of doubt in my mind, okay, if I'm being honest with myself.
So,
Is that doubt a reasonable conclusion for an objective person?
I'll actually amplify what you're saying. I won't disagree. I would go as far as saying what Dennis Noble said, which is that 90%, above 90% of scientists do believe neo-Darwinism is sufficient. Now, I actually...
Thank you.
Well, no, that's
no,
what...
It's good that people know that.
No, of course.
Okay.
One of the arguments that was made during the discussion between Richard Dawkins and Dennis Noble, and Dawkins made this point in his new book, which was just released, The Genetic Book of the Dead as well, which is, if Dennis Noble is right, then all of the scientists that have been working for decades and publishing papers in genetics, in zoology, in biochemistry, all this stuff, they've all had the wrong assumption. They've all had the wrong framework. So I agree with you.
You may be correct, but as a layman, that's another assertion which is being made by another expert in the field in the face of hundreds of experts in the field who would disagree with that assertion.
No.
So as a layman, I've still got to conclude it's undecided at best.
Let me explain something. I'm not actually disagreeing with what you said. I'm actually amplifying it.
Oh, okay.
I'm saying, you pointed out 2,000 something scientists. I'm saying the vast majority of scientists believe in neo-Darwinism.
Right.
I actually don't disagree with that.
So in the face of that, why are you 100% confident? So we get religious for a minute. I'm hoping it's something more than just going, because I've accepted that the Quran is the literal truth, that's my predicate, and anything which contradicts it must be wrong. I'm hoping that's not the crux of your argument. I'm hoping that you can accept, you're 100% rejecting neo-Darwinism for another reason apart from...
Okay, so, yeah, but let me just explain something. Dennis Noble believes in human-chimp ancestry. He believes in all species came from one origin. So when I'm talking about the third way of evolution, Carl Woese, James Shapiro, Scott Turner, or any of these guys, they all still believe all of life came from one cell, essentially, right? They don't deny universal common ancestry. So this discussion is about the mechanism of evolution. It's not actually about universal common ancestry. However, the question that you've asked is a good one. Why am I 100% certain? And I would say this, Tony.
Yeah.
I'm not 100% certain.
Wow.
I'm not.
That doesn't mean that you're wrong.
But I am 100% certain about one thing.
Yeah.
I'm not 100% certain the third way of evolution is correct.
Yeah.
I am certain 100% that there is significant challenges to neo-Darwinism which have not been addressed, and therefore the jury is out.
Okay.
I believe the jury is out. Okay. So, for example, Dennis Noble said neo-Darwinism is dead. I don't believe neo-Darwinism's dead. I believe the evidence for neo-Darwinism is dead, but I believe it's alive in all of the biological circles. I believe sociologically the theory is far too strong to be upended by Dennis Noble in the third way of evolution.
Okay.
Right. So,
but do you think it's also reasonable for a layman? For a layman. Cheers. I was going to. I'll tell you in a minute. We're chatting right now. It's reasonable for a layman to say the jury is out.
I believe that too.
Okay. Therefore, it's reasonable for a layman to have doubt as to which of the two beliefs they have. So it's reasonable for the layman to have doubt that evolution is the intelligent design is the truth.
Okay, so
and we know we're heading towards Shrek.
Let me just point out one small thing, which is...
I'm not trying to smash the religion. I'm just trying to, you know, stress test.
Yeah, no worries. Let's stand here. So just to end the point, because we're going to have to move.
Okay.
The third way of evolution has nothing to do... we're just filming here. Give us 1 second. The third way of evolution has nothing to do with intelligent design. Neo-Darwinism has nothing to do with intelligent design. Proponents of third way of evolution and intelligent design are both critics... proponents of neo-Darwinism and the third way of evolution, Dennis Noble, James Shapiro, all the, they're all critics of intelligent design. So this debate...
Are we not micromanaging different strands? It's like arguing about different strands of... democracy, yeah? You can have first past the post, you can micromanage the argument about the strengths and weaknesses, but the basic principle stands, and the basic principle of evolution, neo-Darwin or otherwise, is one of non-intelligent design through random mutation and then adaptivity to the environment.
This is where I disagree.
But would these 190 scientists disagree?
I think we've convoluted 2-3 different issues here. Let me just explain something. This is something I cover in my new book, which is going to be published by the end of the year, right? By Sapience Institute. Neo-Darwinism and the third way of evolution both do not undermine the idea of design. They both do not. That is not a scientific position. It's a philosophical position based upon where you start off from. It's got nothing to do with the science itself.
I understand. This is your assertion. And now I'm saying, if I ask these 190 scientists if it does or not, they would disagree with me. Yes?
I don't...
It doesn't mean they're right, but as a point of fact, it's very likely they would disagree with me.
So this is where it gets a bit confusing. Francis Collins is part of the National Academy.
Francis Scott. 190 people. Here.
Yeah, I'm giving you an example of one that I know.
If I ring the NAS and I ask them, do you agree with Sabour's assertion?
What's my assertion?
Your assertion that creationism is compatible with Darwinism.
No, it wasn't creationism. I didn't say creationism.
Intelligent design.
Let me say the statement and you can ring them and check it.
Please. Hey, I'll write it down.
Yeah, sure. Oh, you can listen to the recording.
Okay, cool.
The belief in design, the belief in God, the belief in intelligent design is not a position which is undermined by neo-Darwinism or the third way of evolution. That's an independent philosophical position that has its own arguments, so people may believe it or not believe it. Science itself is silent when it comes to these metaphysical issues, which is the position that you would have if you take the philosophy seriously. Wow.
This isn't working. I had a bigger problem with this one.
In fact, they say it too. There's a section there where it says evolution doesn't undermine God in the same paper you gave me.
I think you're trying to reframe it as a metaphysical question. And
it is, though, it is.
Well, if you ask, is God involved, it becomes a metaphysical question. But you can ask the question of evolution purely within the framework of biology, which is what the Nobel Prize-winning scientists are attempting to do. Yeah? And within that framework, it's a very cogent interpretation, I think. They may be wrong, but you're asserting... that they're definitely wrong, or are you asserting they might be right? No. Or are you asserting there's no contradiction?
No. So let me just make it clear. They believe intelligent design is pseudoscience based upon bad argumentation. I already spoke to you about that earlier. But no scientist in the world can use evolution to say that design is an illusion unless they're using a metaphysical framework.
You can't prove there's no design. But
using science.
You can't prove there's no design using science, but you can argue as to the mechanism by which design was achieved. And it's possible that design was achieved via the evolutionary mechanism which they propose. It's also possible it was achieved via Adamic exceptionalism, which has also been suggested. So these are three possible mechanisms. Number one, God magically goes, let it happen, and it happens.
Yeah, okay.
Number two, you get God going, I'll put a process in play, which is that of Darwinian evolution, and I'll let it do the job for me. Or number three, Adamic exceptionalism, which again God puts in play. These are three viable mechanisms, and the point of conflict here is between which of them is the most viable, yeah?
Okay, so let me, just to summarize, none of this is a scientific discussion.
I don't agree. Some of this is. Sure.
Okay, so the premises may involve a scientific fact or
yes.
scientific theory,
yeah.
but the arguments are being made within theories of metaphysics. So
I'm not trying to do that, though.
No.
In that there's you and me talking now, and I can't be responsible for what all these other people think. I'm trying to think for myself. I want to be honest and objective and look at facts. When a bunch of people who are expert in an art and they know more than me say something, I think I'd be foolish to completely ignore them, okay? And I don't want to fall into an argument for an authority. I don't want to slavishly follow them. On the other hand, I can't completely reject them. I'm presented with the theory of evolution, which to me seems thankfully simple, the idea of mutation and adaptation to the environment
is a very simple guide. But Tony, I think you're convoluting something here. That's one theory of evolution. That's the Darwinian theory of evolution.
I know, the Darwinian theory to me at least seems simple to understand and endorsed by a wide body of highly esteemed scientists. Therefore, I can't eliminate that possibility. What I'm left with is, if they're right, if I embrace that they may be correct, is that compatible with a God, an interventionist God, a theistic God, and it may be.
So just to, I think we're converging on a point. Science, oh, we're going to pray there, yeah. Science has nothing to do with this, except as an input in different metaphysical frameworks. So, if you start off with materialism, you input the science to come to a different conclusion. Then if you start off with theism, you come to a different conclusion using the same science. So science is not the adjudicator here. There is philosophy being done. That's all I'm saying.
I'm not saying that you're wrong. It depends on the question you're asking. If you're asking the question, did God create man, then you're asking a question which has got a metaphysical dimension and a biological dimension, yes? But if you just ignore God for a minute and look at the process in the lab of how did these organic beings come to be the way they are, you don't have to engage God in the question at all. It can be a purely biological question. Yeah? Now, these scientists, they're not trying to include God in the picture. They're trying to eliminate all of that, not because they necessarily believe or disbelieve in God, but because God is not a scientific issue. It's a metaphysical issue. Their job is to deal with the physics and the biology. In their attempts to do that, they've drawn certain conclusions which seem cogent, I think, and they seem cogent in the lab, and the idea that the conclusions they've drawn can then be 100% dismissed, which some people assert, seems premature. I think clearly as a layman, I have to adjudicate there is grounds for doubt. Now,
okay.
Doubt to me is not a problem.
Okay, so some things that you've said I don't disagree with, but there is one thing I disagree with, if you meant this. The National Academy of Science, it represents 2,000 whatever scientists.
Sure.
But let's just say it represents 200,000 scientists or 2 billion scientists, whatever it is.
It's 2,500, I think.
Okay, whatever it is.
Okay.
Let's just say they represent all scientists that ever existed.
Okay.
That entire monopoly, if they are, you know, you've given them the credibility in terms of the Nobel Prizes, all these things.
Yeah.
They can still come up with an argument collectively as an academy, which is false. And that is the argument that they came up with in the Dover trial.
Okay, so it sounds like the authority that I'm quoting from has made invalid arguments in the past, and that should be on the record, if you're correct.
And the invalid argument is based upon?
I don't know.
Design.
Hang on. Just because they've made parallel invalid arguments doesn't mean that their core precept is invalid.
So, I'll give you an example.
I'm happy to say they're not perfect. I don't think they're sacrosanct, but I do think if they were here, they would endorse Darwinian evolution.
They would,
as
yeah.
a point of fact. They would.
Yeah, but I didn't disagree with that.
I'd be stupid to ignore them.
I didn't disagree with that.
I believe your viewers as well would be unwise to completely ignore the input of people who are that expert in that field.
Okay.
Yeah? So I'm not saying they're right or wrong, but
so
I don't think you can...
This is the academy that you're referring to, National Academy of Sciences,
yeah.
Okay? Now, their definition of science that they used during the Dover trial,
yeah.
Okay? That definition of science that they actually used was a definition which precluded design, precluded... it entailed naturalism. And the problem is that intelligent design was challenged by this academy by definitions, and that is something which doesn't make sense.
I agree with you that they made a mistake, because there will be a metaphysical dimension. If you accept Darwinian evolution as a biological mechanism, it raises the question, could that mechanism have been initiated by God? And the answer is potentially yes. If so, no problem anymore. We no longer have a conflict between science and faith, which to me is the idea. Yeah?
Okay.
So that squares the
circle. I'm trying to understand if you got my conceptual point, which is that an entire academy can be wrong in the way that it puts forward a particular conclusion.
Yes, they're fallible as well. I'm not saying they're not fallible.
And I gave you the example of the fallibility, which, by the way, just to let you know, there's a guy called... Martin Brudy. I interviewed him about the Dover trial, right? I interviewed him. He's an atheist. He's somebody who wouldn't agree with me on many different things. However, he put together a paper alongside two other academics in which he was basically arguing that intelligent design is basically, according to them, invalid, false, whatever. He believes it's false, but he thinks the way that it should be shown to be false is by making different arguments to the arguments that were made at the Dover trial.
Right.
So he basically puts together five arguments that were used in the Dover trial, and that those arguments are not valid because those were definitional. Mm-hmm. And he believes that there's a better way of showing intelligent design is false than the way that was employed.
He may well be right. Look, I don't expect the...
By the way, I don't agree with him. Okay. On everything, but I do agree with him that they were wrong in terms of the way that they used the Dover trial. They used the definitional way of getting rid of intelligent design in the Dover trial.
Fair enough.
And that is, by the way, that's a big mark against them.
Okay.
Even I would say...
The mark against them is that they may have used spurious arguments to reject a metaphysical position that actually is beyond their jurisdiction. Yeah?
Not a metaphysical position, a philosophical position.
Because
the judge at the trial, he had no training in the philosophy of science, yet he's calling things pseudoscience.
I get it. So look.
Yeah, I mean, okay.
If they fall short within the arena of metaphysics, they may well do.
But can I ask you?
That doesn't mean they're falling short within the arena of biology and physics, does it?
No, I agree with you. I agree with you there. I agree with you. But I just want to end upon one small question.
Hang on, please let us do a damning exceptionalism a bit, because you guys have discussed it as well.
Sure.
And I think it's really constructive for your viewers to know it's on the menu.
Sure.
Yeah? Because no scientist could disprove a damning exceptionalism ever.
I believe if
I took the 190 Nobel Prize winners currently in the National Academy of Science and said to them, can you disprove, is there anything a damning exceptionalism which runs contrary to your beliefs about science, they would have to go nuts.
Yeah.
Okay?
Do you have to do that one, or can you do something more interesting?
No, this is great. The idea that you can bring together the two communities, the religious community and the mainstream scientific community, on a point where there will no longer be conflict, is potential progress.
Okay, so with Adamic... Okay.
Well, yeah, I consider that progress. I consider discord to be less progress than synthesis.
So I want to go over two ways Adamic exceptionalism can be done.
Okay.
And I think it's important to make the distinction. One distinction, and you're right, scientists can't disprove it. It's in line.
If I raise Darwinian evolution, they will go, this is definitely the case, it's not creationism. But if I go Adamic exceptionalism, they'll go, fair enough, we can't argue.
But I do want to add something. If Darwinism...
Yeah, okay. Actually, can we quickly explain what Adamic exceptionalism is?
Sure.
Adamic exceptionalism is the idea that, I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, that the Darwinian evolution, the standard model which is proposed by people, even like Richard Dawkins, is basically correct. That is how it works. But simultaneously, Adam and Eve were miraculously created by an interventionist god in the Garden of Eden, metaphorically.
In an under-the-radar way.
Under the radar, yeah. That Adam and Eve were miraculously created. They had kids who then interbred with the Darwinian kids, which means we are now all the result of both Adam and Eve's genealogy and Darwinian evolution, yeah? Now, what, I don't happen to believe that's true.
But by the way, that...
However, I do recognise that as a concept, it's bulletproof to me being able to disprove it.
Okay.
And no scientist could disprove
it. Sure, but just to add, that's one version of Adamic exceptionalism.
Okay.
That there was interbreeding... Yeah, you described it correctly. There was interbreeding between... Adam's children and Neanderthals. Yeah. That's one version.
So we're now all children of both God and Darwinian evolution. No.
Yeah? Well, we don't believe in children of God, but I'll explain.
Poetically.
Yeah.
Speciation.
Okay. However, there's another version of Adamic exceptionalism I was thinking about, which is...
Sorry, I will get you in.
That those Neanderthals or other Denisovans or whatever it was, all of them go back much further to a common ancestor who was Adam.
Nice.
That's another version.
Hang on, you're talking about an Adam who doesn't just go back 7,000 years.
Yeah,
or
yeah. No, I mean,
this sounds like a metaphorical Adam, not a literal.
No, it's not metaphorical. It could go back 200-300,000 years. Before the Neanderthals,
okay,
before the Denisovans.
Adam arrives as a result of an interventionist god clicking his fingers.
Yeah. Sorry. When it comes to the creation of Adam, we do not say we know the mechanism. So, for example, when you say, I as a Muslim, I have to be clear that God created Adam without predecessors. However, I can't say in this way or that way. Or the time. I can't say anything.
Wait.
Or the time frame.
It's a miracle. As soon as it happened, then it's a miracle. But it's in no way incompatible with the Darwinian thing. Adamic exceptionalism does synthesize the two.
I just thought of something. Let me guess your intention behind this. You're basically saying to me that Shoaib's view is harmonizing, and I'm still challenging Darwinism. Why am I doing it? That's your question, isn't it? Okay, sure.
I like harmonization.
Yeah.
You're a nice guy. You like harmonization.
Sure.
And there's too much conflict in the world.
Sure.
Sure.
But let me explain something. Like, Shoaib is a very good friend of mine. We've known each other for years. But we actually disagree on certain aspects of evolution. Right? No, actually not disagree on certain aspects of evolution. We disagree on approaches. So, I believe intelligent design is science. He believes it's not science. That's a fundamental difference.
You believe intelligent design is science?
Is science, and he believes it's pseudo... He believes it's not science.
I'm with him. It's not.
Okay. You're I believe it's science.
As everything you said before, you're drawing on metaphysical assumptions.
Yeah, okay. So let me,
therefore, it's not physics.
Yeah, it is metaphysics. But let me point out some other things.
If it's metaphysics, it's not physics.
No. Some things are on a gradient, but I'll explain that in a second. The other thing is... I believe in challenging Darwinism. He doesn't believe, he believes conceptually his book is about if Darwinism's true, what can we accept, what can we reject? So our approaches are totally different. And we actually had a podcast on this. You can see the podcast. It's quite interesting, right? Long story short, despite what you've said, I still believe it's important to challenge Darwinism.
Okay, I hear it. I just, as a layman, what am I supposed to do? You spend your life reading a whole load of stuff I'm not going to have access to.
Sure.
Read loads of facts. You've drawn a conclusion from those facts. A bunch of other people who seem to hold in some regard, because they quote other scientific ideas you embrace, they've looked at the same facts and drawn different conclusions.
But they don't believe in intelligent...
Sure,
but they don't believe in intelligent design. I want to make that clear. Dennis Noble, James Shapiro, they reject intelligent design.
Okay.
They reject, but I mean, they accept common ancestry.
Would they accept intelligent design if I said to them that God used evolution, Darwinian evolution, as a mechanism for it?
They do not accept any of this. They are naturalists.
Yeah.
They believe in the naturalistic program.
I get it.
Yeah.
I get it. But so that's it, their metaphysical, so, the minute they reject the idea of God, they're making a metaphysical.
Yeah, yeah. So let me explain. I'll summarize it. Yeah, sure. Okay. So before I go,
can you define what we mean by metaphysics for a minute? I had a discussion with someone before, because different people mean different things by it, and I mean something quite unusual, actually. So I use it in an unconventional sense anyway. What do you mean by metaphysics?
I believe, firstly, there is no clear distinction between physics and metaphysics. I believe there's a gradient, right? There's a gradient. Questions of a nature of ontology, a nature of epistemology, they are definitely philosophical questions. Questions of a purely...
They're
metaphysical questions. But questions of a purely observational perspective are purely scientific.
Yeah, natural science.
Yeah.
So we have natural science, which studies objects and energy.
Yeah.
Things with matter and
matter, space, time.
Matter
yeah.
and energy.
Yeah.
And we have metaphysics, which studies things...
Ontology, theory of knowledge, yeah. However, I believe there's a gradient. It's not clear-cut at certain points.
Oh, I've got a clear-cut line.
For example, the beginning of the universe is physics and philosophy. It's both.
That's a very wide assertion. Can I give a counter thing where it's simple? I think there is a very clear-cut line. If you have matter or energy, in other words, if you're made of stuff, I'll call it stuff, because matter and energy are the same stuff, E equals mc squared. If you have matter or energy, you're an object. If you exist ontologically, but you don't have matter or energy, you're metaphysical. I.e. qualia would be a good example. Yeah, qualia would seem to have no matter or energy.
Okay, okay.
So it's real, but it's a metaphysical thing.
So I'm going to have to disagree with you there.
Okay, go on.
Qualia is probably the worst example to use.
It's the best example to use.
Okay, so whether someone looks at qualia... Okay. Are brain states equal to mental states from your perspective?
There seem to be correlations.
Okay.
Yeah.
That correlation is not sufficient to rule out anything non-material. Correlation of neurons, a correlation of brain states to mental states doesn't justify physicalism.
I'm not trying to justify physicalism. I'm saying qualia transcends physicalism, hence it's metaphysical.
Oh, you believe it transcends? Okay.
Well, it seems to be where else can I categorize
okay,
it.
Sorry.
Qualia is my hobby horse. Okay.
Sorry, I misunderstood you. I thought you said qualia... brain states equal mental states. I misunderstood you. Okay, fine. So you're the same boat as me.
Okay, let's backtrack into metaphysics.
By the way, just to let you know, you know the main guy behind the consciousness for the past like couple of years. What's his name?
The guy who died.
No, not the guy who died. Robert Lawrence Kuhn.
Oh yeah. Actually, I don't know much about him. I know the name. I've seen him on a couple of things.
So he's the guy who's written a paper called The Landscape of Consciousness, right? This paper was published this year and it's 175,000 words. So it's all of the views of consciousness, right? And he's not a materialist, right? So we're in convergence from the perspective that qualia is a good example of something, however...
Intangible, physically intangible, but irrefutably real.
Yes. However, it's also an example that there's a gradient between the physical and the metaphysical.
Okay.
Qualia's in the middle.
Right. I think you're using the word gradient in a way I don't understand. I would say it's a clear line. If it's physical and I can measure it, then it's not metaphysical, it's physics. If it's not measurable but real, it must be in another dimension, yeah? Which is therefore a metaphysical dimension. Now, my experience of qualia, yeah, is clearly doesn't contain matter or energy, so it's not within the domain of physics. But you can't pretend it's not real, because irrefutably I feel stuff, yeah? Therefore, there is a dimension to reality, ontological reality, which transcends physics.
Yes.
That seems to be logically irrefutable. And that's the platform from which most religions, I would argue all religions are right.
Sure.
Yeah?
It seems to be...
So we're on the same page.
Yeah, we are. But I want your view on this. So I hosted a discussion between Michael Ruse and Stephen Law on consciousness.
Okay.
And one of the views that was discussed was illusionism. That consciousness is an illusion and qualia is simply a physical phenomenon.
That's a meaningless assertion.
Okay, good, good. I agree with you.
That Sharon Lanny has said that. He said consciousness is the one thing which calling it an illusion doesn't in any way undermine it, because it's not consciousness. It's not what it diagnoses, it's that it exists at all. So it doesn't matter if it's an illusion, it's still inevitably so. Yeah? So call it an illusion is meaningless. If I say that that bush is an illusion, yeah, I could then touch it and discover and pull through it and change something. But my consciousness inevitably is what it is.
Okay.
So you can call it an illusion, you're just tarnishing it. It doesn't mean anything. It's real, irrefutably real. The word illusion means nothing in that context. So you can't dismiss consciousness.
Yeah. So
we agree.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. I just wanted your perspective on this, because I think consciousness is the mother of the problem, the mother of the issue when it comes to naturalism. I think it's the one thing that naturalists find most hard to explain.
Agreed. The mystery of consciousness is an ongoing enigma.
Yeah.
I suspect it will be forever. My thesis is that it's the one which religion has consistently been addressing, the dilemma of being a conscious entity.
Which, by the way, Michael Ruse, when I asked him earlier on this year, he said it will never be solved by science. He said,
no, I don't think it will either.
Yeah, yeah.
It can't be dealt by physics, yeah?
Yeah?
But it can't be refuted ontologically.
Yeah.
And trying to square the circle will be the eternal quest of human beings. Yeah. Yes? But we need to do it as cogently as possible in a way which does service to both dimensions of reality, the intangible and the tangible. Backtracking into evolution, currently there seems to be a bit of a mismatch between those two views. I think anything which helps to harmonize them is more constructive,
no.
Which is why I promote Adamic exceptionalism just as a thought experiment, even
yeah.
though I don't believe it.
So this is the only, I guess the only point where we disagree is I believe it's still very important to challenge Darwinism head on. One of the metaphysical abuse that the Darwinists have done. Two, because of the ethical implications of Darwinism.
Okay, now we're getting deep. Okay, the ethical implications.
But the metaphysical is more important than ethical.
To me, the ethical is more important.
Because they're linked.
Okay,
once you challenge the metaphysical, you challenge the ethical.
Can we focus on the ethical?
Sure.
Because ethics is the thing I like. Ethics and qualia is kind of where I'm at. Okay. Prima facie, Darwin's theory of evolution seems ethically abhorrent.
Ethically?
Abhorrent.
Okay.
To me, yeah? It paints a very dark picture of the human being.
Nature's red in tooth and claw.
It will see nature war in tooth and claw. Look after number one. Don't worry about anybody else. It's the antithesis of what most good religions, including stuff in the Quran, teaches, yeah? So you can see where on the surface there'd be at loggerheads. But I don't think you should give up on it at that point. If you dig a little bit deeper, maybe it's possible to synthesize. And some work, more work should be put into trying to do it. Dawkins himself, in his documentary series he did, in his second episode, and this was about 20 years ago, I think, I remember him watching it, he went, things are making such a clear-cut argument for tooth and claw evolution. How is it the species hasn't wiped itself out? How is it that somehow we seem to be progressing? Yeah? Broadly, we're becoming a little bit more ethical, a little bit more human, humanized, and so on. And he acknowledged that somewhere in the mix there must be a counterbalancing positive force, because his basic premise is so bleak, we shouldn't be doing as well as we're doing. So he acknowledged, in a sense, he's missing something. One theory he had was that evolution would originally be that you favoured your own gene pool, yeah? So you favoured your family and your nephews and your nieces, whatever, over other gene pools. But the mutate which gave you empathy for your particular peer group. But at some point, a random or divinely inspired mutation occurred where that instinct to empathize with your peer group happened to extend then to the wider community of human beings themselves. And when that happened, that was the evolutionary leap into us being fully functional ethical beings, yeah? So he, even within his own mechanism, he could see how we could evolve through mutation to be the ethical paradigm that your religion embraces and I would advocate.
Yeah?
Yeah?
So
why can't we should give some ground to that instead of just attacking it?
Sure.
Because it might be a way of synthesizing the two worldviews.
Sure. What I would say to that is that the idea that Darwinism can be synthesized with our humanity
yeah.
goes back a few decades to W.D. Hamilton.
Okay.
And W.D. Hamilton, and then afterwards Dawkins popularized it, they had the theory of kin selection to explain our humanity. And then afterwards, reciprocal altruism was another theory.
Yeah.
And then, like you pointed out, the expanding circle. Okay?
Sorry, do you want to bring Jamie in?
No,
you pointed out Peter Singer's expanding circle. I've spent years studying the ethical arguments they've come up with, and I disagree with all three of them. So kin selection, reciprocal altruism, and the expanding circle, I think are flawed theories.
What do you mean by reciprocal altruism? Because to me it sounds like empathy and it sounds good.
Does so reciprocal
back?
Altruism is...
Yeah,
for adaptive benefits. Okay?
Yeah.
So I disagree with them heavily. If you wait for me a few minutes, I'm just going to pray and then you carry on.
No, of course.
I'm just going to pray and then...
I'll pray with you.
Oh, come. Can you? I'll keep it. Shall I keep it on? Ah, okay. Thank you.
Can I follow your lead?
Yeah, that's fine.
You have rusty?
Allahu Akbar. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim.
Allahu Akbar.
Subhanallah al-hamida. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. All the connection with other pensions become also linked. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. سمي الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah. Thank you, brother. Thank you so much. What's your name?
Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah. I'm from the States and I'm Uyghur myself. So Allahumma barik for.
Oh, Uyghur.
For
okay.
The voice that you like speak upon our people.
Yeah. No. Wait. What's your name?
Muhammad.
Muhammad. Let's. Let's speak after this, inshallah. He's a Uyghur.
He's a
Uyghur.
Okay.
From China, because you know I do Uyghur activism.
Oh,
so
they've been oppressed, yeah?
Yeah, yeah. So going back to kin selection, what was it?
Kin selection. You were talking about reciprocal altruism. You three interpretations of the theory you don't like, one of which was reciprocal altruism.
Oh, yeah, who was with us? Where's he gone?
Jamie was over there.
Okay. Yeah. So the.
Can I nail it down to empathy? I think the key is empathy, yeah? Something made us empathic. I think the essence of ethical goodness is empathy, which is when you're sensitized to what's going on inside another subject apart from yourself, yeah? It's not something all animals have, but we seem to have jumped the shark on it in a very positive way, yeah? Dawkins seemed to be pointing out how through a scientific lens, a biological lens, that could have happened through mutation. Religion seems to show on a narrative level how it could have happened.
Okay.
I'm interested in how much you can synthesize it.
So, before we synthesize, I want to point out, what are the three things which Dawkins, Singer and others are pointing towards, and why I disagree with them? Okay. They're basically trying to explain our moral sense from a Darwinian perspective.
Yeah.
And the crux of the argument is, we are moral for the benefit of our genes. So the way it begins,
unless God intervened to manipulate the genes to behave that way.
Yeah, but obviously he doesn't believe in God. Dawkins.
He doesn't, but I'm not him. I'm pushing the notion. Sure. He may have missed it, but I'm on board.
But
maybe God manipulated the genes to do it, and then we don't have a problem.
But the naturalistic explanation that Dawkins points out. Kin selection is the idea you're good to your kin because they carry your genes.
Which makes sense.
Reciprocal altruism, it does. But this is.
Scratch my back, I scratch yours.
Yeah, no, that's reciprocal altruism. The expanding circle is it just goes wider and wider from the family to the town to the city to the village.
Which is a positive trajectory.
Right. However, many philosophers and even scientists have pointed out these theories are flawed because there's recalcitrant facts against them. We, for example, we're not talking about God here, we're talking about the naturalistic understanding. We're good to people that will never benefit us and are not related to us. Now, David Stove wrote a book called...
But I just covered that with what he said. The point was, if the ability to empathize just went rogue, it went off-piste, and suddenly I'm empathizing with everybody, even if they're not in my gene pool, that's actually an ethical upgrade.
So, no, no.
It's thrown free of its origin.
I just want to point out, because you're a smart guy, you're going to look this up yourself as well.
Yeah.
Philosophers have pointed holes in these arguments. These arguments where empathy and altruism has become a runaway process of itself.
I don't doubt they have. It doesn't mean they're right.
I want to summarize what their arguments are, why they disagree.
Okay.
Obviously, some agree, some disagree.
Uh-huh.
The best arguments have been put forward by David Stove in his book, Darwinian Fairy Tales. Mm-hmm. What he does is he tackles kin selection and reciprocal altruism because the expanding circle of altruism being a runaway process, it breaks down if kin selection fails, because it starts with kin selection. Reciprocal altruism builds on it, and expanding circle builds on it. So it's like a Russian doll going back, yeah? So kin selection as a theory totally fails because the predictions of inclusive fitness theory that W.D. Hamilton put forward, they have been shown to have recalcitrant facts. For example, we don't sacrifice ourselves for even people who are related to us, and in some cases we sacrifice ourselves for people who are not related to us.
Yeah, which is a good thing.
No, it is a good thing.
Yeah.
But what I'm pointing out to you is the naturalistic Darwinian story doesn't account for morality in that way.
But the narrative I just gave, the interpretation I just gave you...
Your interpretation does.
I'm paraphrasing him, but even if he didn't, I'll give it, okay? Let's just assume it's my idea for me. Random mutation takes a raw ability to empathize due to self-interest, and it goes rogue, and suddenly empathy is born universally.
Yeah,
that would be a breakthrough moment, and it's credible and compatible with Darwinian evolution, and it doesn't disprove the creationist life.
Yeah, it's a fantastic idea, but it's false. That's the problem.
I've never heard that phrase often, but it's a fantastic idea and it's false.
No, okay.
It's impossible. No, really?
It doesn't take off. Okay, now Dawkins himself, in a debate with John Lennox, you know John Lennox, they...
No, you'd be amazed how little I know about okay.
So, so John Lennox, he's a mathematician from Oxford University, he's a Christian. They had a debate. During the debate, John Lennox showed how the ethical arguments that he was making are flawed. Right, you disagree with that?
So I should explain, this is a friend of mine, Felix.
Okay.
Maybe at some point he could chip in if you've got some things.
I think John Lennox is an absolutely ridiculous person.
Okay, hang on.
I think he's completely intellectually compromised.
But let me point out what he said and let's see if you disagree with it.
Do you want to
right?
Sure.
Hang on, seeing as I've introduced you guys, can I just quickly, because Felix may not know, we've chatted a lot, we've gotten really well. I'm trying to keep it as constructive as possible.
That was me coming in at a ridiculous level.
Okay, so if you want to tone that one down, that would be cool. And then, because he's very bright and he does a lot of philosophy. And
sure.
So can we have a conversation here from everybody's point of view?
So the point that John Lennox said in a debate with Richard Dawkins was about Dawkins' statement that we should rebel against our genes. And what Lennox said is that conceptually, how does that make sense that we rebel against our genes? What is it in us that actually rebels? So the argument was about whether we are supposed to dance to our DNA according to what Dawkins writes himself in River Out of Eden and other books, and how it is that we can rebel against our nature when we ourselves can't be a separate being from our nature. So conceptually, the argument of rebelling against our genes is incoherent. That's what Lennox was saying.
But don't you think we're what makes unique as humans part is that we are aware of our nature?
Can I say that again?
We're aware of our nature in a way no other animal is. I mean, you can point to maybe like dolphins hunt for sport, monkeys make rudimentary tools and can count and stuff. They're pretty intelligent, but humans are way beyond that.
So,
and we've done the research to the point where we've solved the twin nuclear bomb, we've split the atom, and we've split the cell. We've discovered DNA, and we're still at the foothills of all the research it will take to understand that. Do you not think that our very awareness of it can allow us to understand it and do things to sort of change our behavior right through it? Why is that intrinsically not possible?
Repeat your last point again, because I got distracted.
Why is it not the case that our awareness of our nature can allow us to transcend it?
Okay, so I would say that's an interesting point, but it's not the point I was referring to in terms of Lennox, because that's a conceptually, I mean, you may disagree with Lennox in terms of other stuff. In fact, some of the stuff Lennox said in terms of the arguments that he's made, I think are fantastic. There's other things I disagree with him on, but this particular point that Dawkins made, that we should rebel against our DNA, I think is incoherent. I think Lennox was right about that. What is it that rebels?
Why can't we even try us? Our consciousness, our body is our psychology, everything.
So,
of course, all those things come from our DNA.
Yeah. So that's the point. That's the point he was making.
But,
yeah.
Well, yes. That is true.
So you agree with Lennox that it's incoherent? It doesn't make sense.
No, I do not agree.
Okay.
That it's incoherent.
So, what makes you think that us saying we are, firstly, like you said, we're the product of our DNA,
yes,
and then saying we should rebel against our genes.
Okay, forget
what Lennox says. What I'm saying is Dawkins is incoherent in what he's saying here.
I don't think so. Like, we can look at similar cases in the animal kingdom. For example, if you look at like lions, lion kills the other lions, becomes alpha in the pack, has sex with a lioness, has some baby lions, and then eventually wanders off, comes across another tribe of lions, and wants to make a new partner because he's the alpha lion, he wants to do that. Lioness has existing children from a previous marriage or relationship with the previous lion. What is the alpha lion going to do to those children?
He's going to kill them,
right? This has been documented, several nature films, because he doesn't want them to remind him of the other lion's peg bite. So that is, and you can see that in other sort of similarly tribal kind of mammalian species, hunter and sort of predator type species. So presumably some of that DNA is in the human genome at some level, right? Do humans go around, if they have second, third marriages, they kill the children of their wives from the previous marriages?
No.
Not in general, no. So is that not an example of where we can transcend our innate?
The evidence suggests that we have transcended.
So look, I think there's a misunderstanding here. We both agree on the fact. The theory behind the fact is what Lennox and Dawkins were disagreeing about.
Yes.
So Lennox was pointing out God as the cause of our moral sense. Dawkins was saying we rebelled against our DNA.
Yes.
Right? Now, so what you've articulated here, we don't disagree on the fact. The point is, the concept of us... Now, here's something I do want to point out, and I said this to you earlier.
Yeah.
Kin selection, reciprocal altruism, and the expanding circle,
mm-hmm.
those are theories that I disagree with, I believe are false, but they're coherent.
Yeah.
I believe they're coherent.
Yeah, they are.
However, what Dawkins said about rebelling against our DNA is incoherent.
Okay.
I'll explain why.
Can I chip in on why that may be wrong, just as a layman? Because you guys are on a higher level than me now.
Sure.
But rebelling against my DNA, surely mutation is precisely what that would be. Mutation would be the thing when you are rebelling. You have an existing paradigm. Which, no, it can't change its nature except for mutation, which is the rebellion you're talking about, which creates the upgrade. That's what evolution speaks to.
Okay, so that doesn't...
Which is how that works at the level of natural selection, but now it could happen even faster.
Okay,
now
we're but starting
to develop gene editing technologies like
No, but CRISPR. there's a problem here.
What if you could edit your own DNA? Our DNA
today came about, according to Darwinists, by random mutations
yes.
being selected.
Yes.
Adding random mutations to that process doesn't make us more moral, right? It doesn't solve the problem. You're just adding more of the same thing. If DNA is something to be rebelled against, how DNA came about to add to that process...
You're not rebelling against DNA, you're rebelling against the paradigm that DNA is instated. That's not the same thing.
Okay, so...
So there's a pattern of behavior the DNA instates, but you use the DNA then mutates and creates a new pattern of behavior.
Okay, so...
So you can transcend your previous behavioral pattern. That would be the theory, which would account for male lions eating other offspring, whereas we wouldn't.
No, but that's not what even Dawkins was referring to.
But the
conversation started off with why that is incoherent. Okay, so let me just explain and summarize, because I'm going to make it quick, why I believe that's totally incoherent. And later on we can get into the coherent things, kin selection, reciprocal altruism, and expanding circle, which are coherent, but I can show that they have major flaws. Okay, now when it comes to that idea of rebelling against our genes, Lennox points out to Dawkins, what is it within us that actually rebels? Now, if you're a naturalist, you're going to be wedded, most likely, especially someone like Dawkins, to some form of monism. That the mind is the brain at work. That's it.
Yeah.
So from that perspective, it's incoherent to say rebel against your genes. Secondly, the other point is, why rebel against your genes? There's two problems here. One is the origin of the rebellion. The second is, why follow that imperative? Why not accept the genes?
Why?
Conceptually, because I might think that the genes are incentivizing us to perform actions which I think are immoral, and I would like to not do those.
Yeah, but that's circular.
Why is it circular?
It's circular because you want to be good, but I'm saying, why would you want to be good in the first place?
That's my base assertion. I'm saying.
Yeah, but what's the justification for that?
What's the justification for wanting to be good? That at some point I have to have a base assertion, right? You can't expect me to keep it for it to be titled all the way.
Okay, but Darwinism has programmed us to be selfish.
But
why are you going against that state?
But we
yes, it has. But
oh, thank you for admitting that, by the way, because a lot of people just don't know that.
But I did. That's the whole point of that book. Yes, of course I agree with that. But just because it has programmed us in that way, does not necessarily mean we have to be that way. We can decide with our free will. You believe we have free will, right? To be different and not constantly murder and rape and steal and lie away.
Okay, but there's a gap between the nature and the actions that you think are correct. So, for example,
why does this have to be intellectual? Why can't I just decide and assert with my consciousness and free will?
Because it's not coherent from a materialist perspective. Because if you think the materialist level is dictating the cognitive level, then you can't
You said it better than I. That's what I was trying to articulate.
Okay,
yeah.
My counterposition is then you're planning to an extent because I'm not a materialist. Okay. You're attacking the views, the logical consequences of people who are materialists, and you're correct. But I'm not. I've got a more nuanced view.
By the way, just to point out, can you repeat that again? Because you articulated it.
Sure,
okay. But that was good. That was really good. That was good. Okay. So what you said is, if we were programmed and even our consciousness ultimately started off with that DNA.
If the mind is purely caused by the brain, so if the material brain purely causes the mind as like an epiphenomenon, then it would be incoherent to argue that we could...
That's the point I was making.
Which is what you're suggesting.
That's the point I was making.
Okay. But
I'm not saying you're incoherent, okay. I'm saying Dawkins is incoherent.
Unless
so do you agree with that?
Okay. I would unless there's a feedback loop, and Karl Popper and people like that have argued there may be a feedback loop. If you watch the recent debate with whoever it was, I can't remember. Whoever it was, forget it. Penrose and Adamic, Penrose and analytical idealism, him, Bernardo Castro. They both argue that the function of
idealism, okay. Do you believe in that?
I tend to keep about three or four possibilities on the board. Okay? Materialism is one possibility I'll keep on the board, but I don't want to be anchored to it because I'm also panpsychism, I think we both think is also potentially true, and analytical idealism.
Okay, so can I just add something? I just want to, it's very important to clarify definitions, as you know.
Okay.
Why did you make a distinction between panpsychism and materialism?
Because in materialism, the mind would be caused by the brain. In other words, whereas...
It's emergent.
I'm not sure emergency, it's just a causal relationship. Maybe emergent, but it's caused by it, yeah? Whereas in panpsychism, the mind would be a property of the brain.
Right.
And being caused by something is not the same as being a property of something. For example, if you've got a red car, the redness of the car isn't caused by the car. Whereas if I paint a car red, then I am causing the redness, yeah?
Sure.
So the relationship is different in the two models.
Sure.
Now, matter has an inherent element of qualia to it, a latent element, which is the premise of panpsychism, then it's a very different universe to explore.
Sure, but some materialists, the reason why I'm saying this, some materialists say the universe is made of four fundamental building blocks.
Uh-huh.
Time, space, matter, qualia.
They acknowledge qualia, but the material.
Yeah. This is the reason I pointed it out is because this is a fringe view in materialism.
Okay.
Some materialists say we can accept qualia and still be materialist. We can be panpsychist and materialist.
That sounds weird. I think time and space are emergent properties. So I don't know about that.
But that's because you don't believe we began off with consciousness. That's your assumption.
You
believe consciousness is an emergent property?
No, I didn't say that.
What did you say then?
I'm open to the panpsychist view as well.
He's open to the point
with being open to multiple conflicting and competing possibilities is I'm sure we're not anchoring ourselves into a single position. I'm not pinning my flag to the mast, which you can accuse of that non-committal and whatever, but we're just humans in this crazy big universe. Of course I don't know how it works.
Right.
No one does.
But I do want to say one thing, which is quite categorical. I think materialism is categorically false.
Okay. Explain why.
Well, we spoke about qualia earlier.
Yeah.
That is the clearest evidence, because if we go back to Descartes' dictum, I think, therefore, I am is the only thing you could...
I am is sir.
Yeah. Well, we can translate that to the modern day. I'm conscious, therefore I am.
Yeah.
Right? So, if consciousness, and I believe it has... We've argued for it for enough decades to know this now. If consciousness cannot be explained from a naturalistic way, then materialism must be false. And I say that categorically, by the way.
It's a strong argument.
It is.
However, there are more things in heaven and earth than the dreamt of the new philosophy, Horatio, okay? I understand the limitations of my mind, and I should have respect for the unknown unknowns.
That's known as mysticism, by the way.
Okay, but I'm into mysticism. I'm a deistic and all of that, okay? And because so much of the data which is gathered from the materialistic platform, which seems cogent, it keeps paying off. The materialists keep delivering again and again in the lab. I would be foolish to immediately discount that platform. I see the
except for consciousness, which is the base, which is the basis of everything.
Penrose has, of course, done lots of research into this himself.
So who else? Sorry?
Penrose, Roger Penrose.
Oh, right.
He's worked with anaesthetists on these structures inside the brain called microtubules. He said things like consciousness is not a computation. I think Penrose is thinking of this and it's brilliant, but he's very aware that there is it's almost like the gap between two synapses in the brain, or Adam and God trying to reach out, and they can't quite connect. It's like the missing link, not in the sense of evolution, because there is no missing link there, but...
I mean, you've heard...
But in the sense of, yes, going from, as we're discussing, the pure... material substrate of the brain to consciousness and the mind. There is it remains a mystery.
Yeah.
But I do not think. I don't think we can categorically say whether or not material science will solve that one day or not. It might be that we have to change our conception of what material.
So I just want to add something. You're familiar with the Mary thought experiment.
Mary thought experiment.
She's in a room that's grey.
Yes.
Right. So. We all recognize, whether you're materialist, panpsychist, theist, we all recognize there's a hard problem of consciousness. We know it's there.
There's a hard problem.
Okay. Now, certain things I think should be ruled out in terms of consciousness. I believe there's two views that should be ruled out. And I want to get your thoughts on this. You may agree or disagree. I believe materialism cannot be justified if the hard problem exists, then materialism has to be false. Secondly, is a probabilistic point I'm going to make, not categorical, which is the view of mysterism, that consciousness is a mystery, our brains didn't evolve to help us solve it. I think that's unjustified considering all of the technological advances that we've done. We've gone to the moon, well, some people believe we don't. We're involved in quantum computing, we're sequencing the genome, we're doing all of this. So I believe it's for materialists, it's a get out of jail card to say, it's too much of a mystery and we'll never solve it. It's better to admit that materialism has been shown to be false.
For the reason I just said, because materialism has delivered so many other positive and coherent solutions to so many pragmatic problems, I don't feel equipped to dismiss it. I see the philosophical problem it presents, and I think you're right.
Can I
Can I just
unpack what you said there and just want your thoughts?
Sure.
Materialism has delivered XYZ epistemically.
Yeah,
right?
In the lab. Predictively, that's where we got our data.
I would say it's not materialism that's delivered, it's empirical science.
The methodology, which
people make synonymous with materialism, but it's not synonymous with materialism because under a deistic view, which is your view, right, which is not materialistic clearly, you would still, as a scientist, produce the same results.
But all the luminaries you've been listing are, you say, materialists, yes?
Which luminaries?
You were mentioning various scientists who were materialists, and you were castigating them for being materialists, yeah?
No, I'm saying
I philosophically agree with you, but I can't ignore their expertise to the point where I can completely dismiss their perspective. Given that qualia is such a mystery and consciousness is such a mystery, it may simply be beyond my grasp.
No.
I think we're missing something. No, I don't know what it is.
Okay, I think you missed the point I was making. The point I was making is the successes that you're pointing to are not due to materialism. They're due to empirical science. And that empirical science can be done by a materialist, a theist, a deist, whoever it is.
Okay, ignore what I said about the people you quoted. Fine. I take your point. Yeah. They've misunderstood the nature of science. Constructive scientific methodology should be more aware of all of the ontological dimensions. Yeah. Except it's not, that's not the brief of physics. It's not the brief of physics to address ontology. It's the brief of physics to address physics, yes? It's necessary that they limit their purview of ontology to a specific field. But once they start paying out predictively in the lab, I have to give them some due respect.
Except,
and just because I have a philosophical problem with going, but that doesn't seem compatible with another idea, doesn't mean I can completely reject the validity of their position.
No, so I agree with you, except when it comes to certain fields. Right? For example, quantum mechanics, you cannot separate physics and philosophy. You cannot. So someone can look at the same phenomena and come up with many worlds, relational, the Copernican, informational, shut up and calculate, whatever it is. But the fact is, the physics is cannot be neatly separated from the philosophy. It's impossible.
Okay, if I were to ask...
Do you mean ontologically and permanently, or just in the present moment of our civilization, where our understanding of quantum physics is right now?
I mean categorically that problem of understanding quantum phenomena
is
okay. So let me explain. Yeah, is joint at the hip, because some problems are not physical or metaphysical. They're both. They're both.
So I can take issue with that. If I were to ask 190 Nobel Prize winners in the Nationalist Academy of Science, I think a fair chunk of them would disagree with you. Example, I think it was Niels Bohr who said, shut up and do the math. Is that Niels Bohr?
Yeah.
There is a view within the discipline which says we specifically must avoid engaging with the arena of philosophy. Philosophers can, but that's not our brief, and it becomes counterproductive when we do. Again, I can't...
I disagree. So look, if you can have 190 Nobel Prize winners,
yeah,
or for example, Stephen Hawking, such a great scientist, but they can say something totally false.
For sure.
Yeah, there's no such thing as philosophy-free science. There's no such thing.
Not in terms of its genesis.
No, it's just not possible. So I don't care whether it's 1,000 Nobel Prize winners or a billion. There is no such thing as philosophy-free science.
But why can't you just be patient? Why can't you just wait for the answer to arrive?
No, you can. But while you're doing the experiments, you're working within a philosophical framework.
Because everything is contained within an ontological and philosophical framework.
Yes.
Yeah? It doesn't follow that I have to engage with philosophy in order to understand a lot about this bottle and the water in it. Yeah.
But you do need to do something, which is, say you're studying my brain drinking this water. So I'm drinking it, and you're looking at the neural correlates, and you're trying to link the mental state to the brain states, right? Now, if you're a neuroscientist,
sure,
and you're like, I hate philosophy, and I'm just studying this correlation,
yeah,
and if you are to derive from that the fact that for a materialist, the brain,
yeah,
has to be the mind for a materialist. It has to be.
None of us are formally materialists here. We're not dismissing
I'm giving you a hypothetical scenario. That neuroscientist has the assumption of physicalism. That's an assumption. So whatever science you're doing, it's going to involve some level of philosophy.
He's not a good scientist. A good scientist would just be going, I'm looking at data and I'm trying to find correlation.
That doesn't exist.
That's a very sweeping statement.
All scientists work within a field that has philosophical assumptions.
Agreed, but the assumption you said they've made may not be ubiquitous.
For example, methodological naturalism is an assumption. That is an assumption. Look, philosophy in the past and science were done together. Scientists in the past were called natural philosophers.
Yes.
Newton was a natural philosopher, Darwin was a natural philosopher, Francis Bacon was
then
a natural philosopher.
You are victim to exactly the same problem yourself, yes?
It's not a problem. I don't think it's a problem.
It's a problem for other people. Why would it be a problem for you?
No, I don't think it's a problem. I think it's good.
Okay, so why are you talking about it so much?
No, because you said you can do science without philosophy. I'm saying you can't.
I'm not.
You're not?
No, I'm saying the job of... No, I don't think you can in practice, but you should aspire to do so. A good scientist is trying to eliminate any value judgment beyond physical because he knows his mind will deceive him, yes? he's aware of all of the qualia problems and cognitive bias in psychology, but he's not studying psychology. So the lab itself is designed to minimize cognitive bias so you can be as objective as possible about material data and then find correlations and so that you can make predictions and test them in a lab.
Okay,
and
so
when you do that, you're limiting, no, you're not interested in does my wife love me, is that a good film, is that nice?
No, but you've
you've in matter and energy.
You've introduced a term I don't agree with.
Which one?
You said cognitive bias.
Well, we all have a cognitive bias.
Yeah? What I meant when I said philosophy is included within the science, I didn't mean philosophy comes with the cognitive biases. I didn't mean that. What I meant is that all scientists work within a philosophical framework.
We agree.
Yeah.
All humans work within a philosophical framework.
It's inevitable, but you can't use that as an argument to trump any... You can't then go, so my philosophical argument trumps your physical argument. Just because all physics is contained within... The whole world is contained within a philosophical and ontological framework. It doesn't mean that you can just ignore any... Like, for example, the world isn't flat, yeah? I don't care what philosophical position you've got.
That's an empirical issue.
I can use this as a practical example. There is no philosophical context you could possibly give which could undermine the assertion that the world is objectively more round than
I agree.
There comes a point at which purely looking at the material data overrides any argument, including any philosophical subtext you may bring. The only kind of philosophical subtext you might try and insert into that would be to be a pure idealist and go, there is no world that's all
okay,
in my
so,
mind.
So let me just explain that the point you made that you cannot undermine someone's science, their physics, by saying, oh, there's a philosophy behind this and therefore my philosophy trumps yours. I agree with you.
Not always. You can use it as a valid tool, but you can't always do it.
I actually agree with you, but what I do believe you can do is point out when it comes to a certain field and someone's coming up with conclusions, you can point out these conclusions are not categorical because there's a physicalist assumption. For example, Daniel Dennett was, and Sam Harris, they're new atheists. They're brilliant in terms of one's good at neuroscience, one's good at philosophy, right? But they're absolutely wrong in terms of, at least Dennett's view, that consciousness is an illusion. Do you see? Sam Harris comes with neuroscience, but Dennett says consciousness is an illusion.
Which we've already agreed is a totally fallacious statement. Because it's real, even if it's illusion.
No, but why is he wrong? He's wrong because...
The reason I just said.
I'm trying to tease out the reason why he's wrong. And the reason why he's wrong is he has started off with the wrong philosophical assumption, and that is of physicalism.
That may be why he's wrong.
No, that is why he's wrong.
There might be other reasons he's wrong. He's just using bad logic. But yeah, he's wrong. He's clear. We can all agree he's wrong. Consciousness being an illusion is ridiculous because it is what it is. Yeah, when you say something's an illusion, you're effectively challenging that it is what it is. But consciousness, by virtue of I think therefore I am, is undeniably your.
Undeniably undermines materialism.
It's certainly problematic.
I would say it's decisive.
See, this is where I think my problem, and I'm guessing Felix's problem with when we talk on these levels with religious people, is your level of certainty. That's the primary thing. We're happy to live in a world where you may be right. I'm not saying I'm sure you're wrong. Maybe you're right.
It's about disposition and temperament. Like, we can have this argument for until the cows come home. But in terms of like how it sits with what we know, what we can know, what we can't know, what we can and can't be categorically certain about, to me, like, I'm happy to just debate all these things. Maybe it could be materialism, maybe it could be panpsychism, maybe it could be deism, maybe it could be something else. But you seem to need certainty.
I would say the evidence leads to that conclusion. But I'll ask you a question to see if you're certain. Is astronomy better than astrology?
Better in what sense?
Huh?
Better in what sense?
As in, it's a science.
as better at being a science. As more predictive power.
Okay, why are you being so certain? Why are you no more skeptical about this? You know, what? So you're challenging my certainty. You're challenging my certainty, but you're certain.
Look,
we all have certainty.
Excuse me. I'm not challenging your certainty. I'm challenging your need for certainty. It's not the same thing.
No, but I think there's a mistake here. It's not the case that I'm in need for certainty, that therefore I find something probabilistic and I make it categorical. I think the evidence makes it categorical. It's not that I'm in need to make it.
I don't understand how you can make this kind of
about materialism. So,
do you have not ontological knowledge of the fundamental rules of logic which underlie the universe?
I wouldn't need that.
So
I wouldn't need that to know that consciousness decisively shows materialism's false. I wouldn't need that for that conclusion.
Okay.
Our third person subjective experience. Sorry? Yeah. Sorry.
Why can't you just say I'm like 99.999%?
No, I.
Because
conceptually, it's impossible for science to solve the problem of hard problem consciousness. My first person experience of drinking water cannot be broken down from a third person neuroscientist studying my brain. It's impossible.
I understand the argument. Why do you need to be dogmatic about it? Why not?
I wouldn't say I'm needing to be dogmatic. I'm saying I'm categorical based upon the evidence.
Pivoting on the word need, which adds a total turn to this, because I think you made a good point to Felix. What our accusation against you is we don't like your 100% certainty. Yeah? We want to have constructive discussion. Your counter-argument to Felix was, is astrology better than astronomy?
The science.
Is it, yeah. And you gave an answer. And you basically and he was asking, are you 100% sure?
No, I'm not. Of course I'm not.
You're
that's
not
a,
100%
sure. That's a judgment. Why is that funny?
Funny.
I'm making a value judgment about whether astronomy is better as a form of science than astrology.
What's your percentage commitment to astronomy being better than astrology?
99.999.
Okay, fine. That was your point. Okay. But would you not go to 99.999?
Why would I ever say 100%?
I mean, for example.
Yes, you're right.
Okay, so going back to Descartes, I think I therefore am. That's a certainty.
But that's the only certainty. Okay. Everything else is speculation.
Descartes' view was to use that certainty to find new certainties.
To find something which is the most probable thing after that. What's
the least shaky foundation?
He got there because he realized I can't trust anything about the homunculus.
Let me break it from the beginning. Yeah. If I start off with I'm conscious, therefore I am. Yeah. I exist.
Yeah.
From that base, I then come up with other certainties, like being a moral human person's better than being an immoral, selfish person, categorically.
That's not a certainty.
Why is that not a certainty? No, it's a certainty for me.
I know it feels like one, but you haven't joined the dots from I think therefore I am, which we all agree is certainty, to being a good ethical person means behaving like this. That's a massive number of steps you have to take. Step out from I think therefore I am into I believe I am in an ordered system. Something, a very, very general assertion like that.
I think there's something missing here. You believe, or I think you believe, everything needs to be justified. I don't.
In terms of probabilities, the only certainty I accept is I am.
Okay, so I believe in self-evident truths.
Yeah, intuitive.
Self-evident.
I think I am is an intuitive.
So I'll lay out some things to you which I don't believe need to be justified.
Go on, please.
And you can use all of these unjustified.
Yeah.
Unjustified doesn't mean false. And then from that you can build a worldview, okay? So I believe it's self-evident, I'm conscious, I'm alive.
Okay. We all agree?
No, we don't have to agree. I'm just telling you what I believe.
No, but if the viewers know that we're at a point of agreement,
I believe truth is intrinsically valuable.
Okay, can we think about that a minute?
No. For me, it's unjust. It doesn't need to be justified. I believe my reasoning capabilities are to be trusted. I believe being a good...
I missed the second one. Let me
lay out my most passionate one.
Truth is inherently valid.
Which is well, one second.
Huge.
One second.
Number two.
Good and evil exists, right? Objectively.
Eternally.
Objectively, eternally, yes.
Is there good and evil at the Big Bang?
I'm going to need you on.
Yes. And my ultimate truth that I believe in, which is I believe God exists, self-evidently.
Can I recap this? Because it's a huge foundation.
Okay, sure.
You believe truth?
Okay, but just one last thing. I believe all of these things with absolute certainty, and I believe they don't need to be justified.
Okay, I think you're epistemologically flawed on the level of certainty. I hope you're right about those things,
and you may be
right about those things. All I'm questioning is how appropriate your level of certainty is, okay? But can I just recap on those points?
Do you agree that not everything needs to be justified? You can have self-evident truths.
I think there's a difference between self-evident truths and foundational assumptions.
An intuitive, unavoidably true.
It's kind of the unique one that trumps. I'd say everything else is a foundational assumption one has to make.
Because everything
in order,
else
in order to do any kind of intellectual work.
Because everything else you said is an inference. Everything else you said has got moving parts.
No, it's not an inference for me.
It is. It may not seem
for example,
like it. As a point
you,
of fact, they are inferences.
Okay.
You are saying if this, then that.
I forgot to add the universe has laws of nature.
That's a conclusion.
No, it's not.
No, it is. You've concluded the universe has laws.
It's a self-evident truth I begin off with to make sense of the world.
It's a proposal. I happen to think it's true.
How specific?
Can we break down one thing at a point? Do you guys agree or disagree that not everything needs to be rationally justified?
You're running away from...
I'm not, because we build from here.
We've been over the I am claim. Doesn't need to find
I'm saying, I've been very, very clear. I'll be very, very clear foundation.
But that's not...
Certainty is I am, precisely because it's intuitive and it's not an inference, yeah? Anything beyond that, which has got any moving parts or chronology or if-then statements or syllogisms, is an inference and therefore may be flawed. It may be flawed simply
not for me.
I know, because and that's where we think epistemologically you've gone a bit too far. I'm not saying your conclusions are wrong, but the path you're walking to get there, I think, is too epistemologically confident. And in order to be able to debate with other people, it helps if you can meet them at a level where you're slightly less epistemologically confident, even though your conclusions may be correct. That's the ground I'm trying to harvest.
Yep.
I see what you're saying, but I think you've misunderstood my position. It's not that I've arrived or justified them. Is I just believe them.
I know you believe them with 100% commitment.
Have you always believed these things?
Yes.
Always.
As far as I can remember.
When you were a baby.
Except for the laws of nature, that's maybe something I thought about later.
So you had to think about the laws of nature.
Sorry?
So they weren't self-evident if you had to think about that.
No, I think you're mistaking me epistemically not having access to a self-evident truth with the existence of the self-evident truth. That's fallacious.
You're mixing your ontology with your epistemology. Whether or not the truth is out there, you are. No, I'm not.
No, you are. Because
I'm questioning your epistemology. The ontology.
Because
the thing may be out
we can
there,
discover self-evident truths.
How can we know they're self-evident? Surely if they're self-evident, we shouldn't need to discover them. They should just be burned into our brains.
Okay. If what you're saying is right, why did it take a lot of labor for, I'm just asking as a question, for Descartes to come to I think therefore I am? His meditations are, I study them at university. It's just
because we
don't start from the ground level. If we're humans, we're just like individual lumps of meat and electricity and water, right?
You're speaking categorically there.
If there is such a thing.
No, that's an
assertion. I claim that we are that, right? And if you want to claim that there is an underlying, singular, intrinsic, ontological truth system that underlies in the entirety of reality, to say that we can just access it as like an individual, like dumb lump of meat,
So, just on your statement, do you believe matter exists categorically?
I can't say categorically. No, okay. I can't say.
That's fine.
I'll go 99%. Minimum 99%.
Yeah, okay. Pretty high.
Is space and time an illusion created in our minds, or does it exist?
Oh, to some extent, yes, absolutely.
Oh,
yes.
You got categorical certainty.
I said to some extent.
Okay. Not how certain you, are you?
It's
fair to ask the question both ways.
Yeah,
we can't say that we don't like 100% certainties and then propose any ourselves beyond
but I'm not,
I am.
But I'm not sure. Yes? I'm not sure defining it on a 0-1 continuum is even that.
Oh, I think it's very useful. We can all understand a percentage scale.
But it's going to be subjective. It's like measuring pain, basically.
No. I'll go 99%.
On matter and space and time, I have no idea. Like,
I've no idea. Maybe, it's a good answer.
Maybe 50, about 50, somewhere in the middle, probably.
Okay.
There's a lot of queries.
I'm not going to challenge you. I was just asking.
I'm familiar with people like Donald Hoffman
and Wolfram.
He's done lots of work on the brain, how our nervous system intakes qualia, light, sound, etc. And there are things that happen in the brain, processes that do change the data, the objective external qualia that our body takes in. It changes it before we actually see it in our visual feed or our oral feed. One of your self-evident truths was, what was it, that our
materialism is challenged categorically by consciousness.
No, there was something about our ability to logically deduce things, or our ability to interpret our environment.
Our ability to reason.
But if you admit that our brains are to some degree not showing us ontologically true reality, then that means to some extent your brain is not representing reality to you. And there may be all sorts of good reasons
argument.
But then how can you assume we have perfect abilities to reason?
Okay, but that's an argument.
Our brains have been.
That's an argument in my favour. That's an argument in my favour because we've recognised that we have illusions
because of our mind. Do we all agree on the distinction?
It's in my favour.
Sorry, let me cut it.
Why?
Please.
No.
Because we detected it.
Please let me. Just foundation stuff.
Sure.
Do we agree on the distinction between phenomenology and ontology? Yeah.
Okay.
There is the world that actually is, and then there is the world as it appears to us. Yeah.